Captain, there's...
Spit it out, man.
The sirens.
The crew froze in fear. The siren mermaids, just ahead, were ready to sing their enchanting song that lured every ship to its destruction on the rocks. So enticing was the melody of the sirens that no man could resist it. Acting quickly while wisdom remained, Captain Ulysses ordered the men to put beeswax in their ears and to tie him to the mast. The crew looked to the captain in bewilderment.
You heard me. Tie me to the mast.
Just as the captain was secured, the sound of the sirens filled the air like a sweet aroma. Ulysses, who had no wax to stop the music, was overcome by its alluring sound and demanded to be untied. He shouted, cursed, threatened torture, but no sailor could hear him. Finally, after the ship was beyond the reach of the song, the captain was released and fell to the deck in exhaustion.
Why?
Why does it seem the things I desire most in this life lead to my destruction? The mast has been my savior today from the siren mermaid's deadly song. In our culture today, many are enticed into following a song that seems pleasurable for a season, but in the end, leads to destruction. This song is the phenomenon of modern recreational dating. Today, I want to share how true love and joy can be found in a sweeter song, God's song. Though this road less traveled might seem difficult, the ending awaits with God's fulfilled promises and blessings. During my time, I want to compare recreational dating, the song of the sirens, to biblical courtship, God's sweeter song. We'll begin by defining dating and courtship, then examine their responsibilities, and finally, observe the results of these different approaches to relationships. I believe the meaning of recreational dating and courtship to be completely opposite. Most teenagers date for the fun of it and view it simply as a social practice. Dating is a way youth can satisfy their selfish desires and lusts and avoid any responsibility or commitment. They can enter these relationships without much effort and just as easily end them, though not without emotional scars. If the individual's expectations or desires are not fulfilled in their current partner, then the couple breaks up and searches for someone else who might better meet their needs. After all, since the purpose of dating is for enjoyment, then why not do what makes you most happy? In contrast, the design and aim of courtship is preparing for marriage. Marriage is a picture of the relationship of Jesus Christ and the church. Therefore, the process that leads to this institution should also be an example to our culture. Courtship involves pursuing a relationship where Christ is in the center, not self or personal satisfaction. Now, courtship, instead of finding the right one, courtship involves becoming the right one. Now, whether or not courtship ends in marriage, both should love the Lord more because of the time spent together. That's the difference between a relationship where God is the foundation and not self. Now, the responsibilities during dating and courtship are just as different. Because dating centers on the happiness of the individual, then there really are no defined expectations or responsibilities. However, in courtship, it's not only meaningful, but it is protected by commitment. When a young man finds a godly young woman, there are certain requirements in Scripture he must seek to fulfill. Vodi Bakum, in his book, What He Must Be, contends, quote, "There are some things a man simply must be before he is qualified to assume the role of a Christian husband. For instance, he must be a Christian, committed to biblical headship, a suitable prophet, priest, provider, and protector." Although there are certain biblical requirements concerning relationships, we must be careful not to rely on a list or a set of rules. Each individual situation will be different depending on their parents' involvement, their situation in life, and their spiritual maturity. "God cares too much about us to give us a formula," writes Eric and Leslie Lee, authors of When God Writes Your Love Story. Quote, "God wants to be intimately involved in every detail, in every step of the way. The minute we try to rely on a formula, we miss the whole beauty of what a God-written love story is all about." Finally, the biggest difference between surrendering the pen of your life to God's hand or keeping it in your own is the ending. Now, although our culture has portrayed dating as a harmless activity, it can include grave consequences. When a relationship is started with intimacy, but then starved of commitment. It has no foundation and is bound to fail. The results of this are broken hearts, destroyed trust, and a deep void, which usually results in the person searching for another partner. What's even more tragic is that this cycle is transferred into the marriage relationship. Infidelity and lack of commitment are major reasons for divorce. Yet I ask you, should we be surprised at the high number of failed marriages when we look and see what they're built upon? In addition, consider more deeply the subliminal message that is sent to parents when a young man is dating their daughter. For instance, imagine a father who owns an illustrious sports car, which he takes care of maintaining. One day, he goes into the garage to go for a ride, when suddenly, he realizes that his prized possession is gone. At that moment, some punk kid pulls into the driveway, driving his car. As the teen gets out, he throws the keys to the astonished father, nonchalantly mutters, "Nice car," and strolls off. Though a trite example, this is what happens when a young man engages the emotions and affections of a young lady and then leaves when he is no longer intent. Philippians 2:3. The Apostle Paul urges us, quote, "Do nothing out of selfish ambition or vain conceit, but in humility, consider others better than yourselves." In Paul's letter to Timothy, he instructs them to treat younger women as sisters in all purity. If Christians really submitted themselves to these verses, they would be regarding each other as brothers and sisters in Christ, not as potential dates. Yet, our culture, and yes, much of the church, has viewed dating as the norm, the standard, concealing the tragedy and regret that can be lived. However, the results for those who are faithful to their future spouse before marriage and honor God with their hopes and desires will be blessed. When young adults conduct themselves biblically in a serious relationship, the outcome not only honors the wishes and authority of the parents, but glorifies God, the author of love. I had the privilege to witness my older brother Michael court and marry a godly young woman. With the permission of both his and her parents, they pursued their relationship, honoring the guidelines set by the parents. I stood at their wedding as one of the groomsmen, realizing that their obedience and patience had been greatly blessed by God. Being faithful to your future spouse will always, always be worth the cost. In Psalms 37:4, it says to delight yourself in the Lord, and he will give you the desires of your heart. A heart fully surrendered and consumed by God is one that is filled with his true love and his song. Now, the legend of the sea captain and the mermaid song is not yet finished. Not far behind the ship of Ulysses came another great ship. These sailors also realized the danger of the sirens and the rocks upon which they sat. "Captain Orpheus, the song of the sirens lies just ahead." All around the ship, the crewmen's voices rang with excitement. The part of the voyage they had longed for had finally come. With a warm smile, Captain Orpheus gracefully lifted a delicate instrument brought to him by his cabin boy. With a gesture of victory, he held it above his head, and the crew around him roared. All eyes were transfixed upon their hero. Captain Orpheus took his stance and began to masterly play the most perfect music men's ears had ever heard. Each crew member became lost in the reverie of the song. All too soon, the siren coastline was out of sight, and the master musician concluded the song he himself had composed. Not a single man on board was tempted by the siren's melody. In fact, no one even noticed it. Although the mermaid's music was alluring and sweet, Captain Orpheus played for his crew a sweeter song. Which song would you choose?